It's my greatest pleasure and honor to introduce, or rather, to who am I to introduce Professor Ginsburg. I don't think I'll say anything more, except for the fact that the topic of the presentation has changed. And what was happening now?
Yeah, this is the title.
The title of the presentation is Unintentional Revelations, Reading History Against the Grain. Professor?
Yeah. I changed the, not only title, but I decided to switch to a different presentation after having heard yesterday's debates. Which were deeply interesting to me, and so I thought that this presentation would be more appropriate. Thank you. It's a great honor to be here again. The starting point of my talk will be a passage from Marc Bloch's Unfinished, Posthumous Methodological Reflections, published under the title Apologie pour l'Histoire, Un métier d'historien, translated into English as The Historian's Craft. The book would be familiar to many of you, but I would like to emphasize that the text of Métier d'historien available today is different from the one that has been read across the world for decades. The weaknesses of the first edition, edited by Lucien Febvre, were pointed out in 1989 by a young Italian scholar, Massimo Mastro Gregori, whose philological scrutiny paved the way to a critical edition published in 1993 by Marc Bloch's son, Etienne. This critical edition has been translated into other languages, although not into English. But besides the critical edition of Métier d'Historien, we have today a series of intermediary texts which allow us, so to speak, to enter the historian's workshop. Some years ago, Marianne Wessel, the Dutch historian, found among Lucien Febvre's papers an unfinished manuscript by Marc Bloch. A few pages began on September 22nd, 1939, at Molsheim in Alsace. For the second time in his life, Bloch, at that time more than 50, had been drafted. In the unbearable months of the Drôle de Guerre, being on the front line where nothing happened, Bloch decided to write a history of the French, not of France, introduced by some reflections addressed to a reader curious about method. Réflexion pour le lecteur curieux de méthode. In those pages, conceived as an introduction to a book that was never written, Marianne Wessel identified the generating cell of Métier d'Historien. Therefore, she included Bloch's 1939 reflections in a Dutch translation of the Métier d'Historien, but strangely enough, they are missing in the French critical edition I already mentioned, published in 1993. In those reflections appears for the first time a theme bound to surface again and again in all further versions, more and more elaborate, of Bloch's Métier d'Historien. In the evidence about the past, Bloch wrote, we may identify two fundamental categories. Some evidence is deliberate. I hope that I will be able to. Some evidence is deliberate. Other evidence says something unintentionally, and even against the intention that inspired it. The first group, Bloch went on, quote, includes writings aiming to inform or to edify the readers, unquote. For instance, Chronicles, Lives of Saints. Yesterday, Lives of Saints were mentioned in the debate. I think it will be interesting to see what we can unfold from this remark by Bloch. For instance, Chronicles, Lives of Saints, memoir in which politicians try to justify their actions for posterity. In the second group, we find merchants' account books, prayers transcribed by clerks, fragments of pottery thrown out by stilts inhabitants. Those heterogeneous pieces of evidence, Bloch pointed out, share one feature. They contributed to the knowledge of the past, of a specific past, unwillingly. Quote, those gestures related to a craft or to household work allowed us the possibility of reconstructing better than many narratives an economic structure, a religious mentality, a material civilization. Unquote. In the last centuries, Bloch continued, the most remarkable advance of historical research can be identified in the larger and larger role attributed to unintentional evidence. A commercial document, a piece of pottery, the name of a person, or the name of a place, can be considered as human traces as valuable as the most vivid chronicles. Quote, the point is knowing how to extract life from them. Les tuer de savoir en extraire la vie. Here Bloch made a further step, developing the distinction he had started from. We tend to ask even to, quote, narrative works, something different from what they pretended to say. Undoubtedly, we are interested in medieval chronicles or in Saint-Simon's memoir for the events they talk about, quote, but even more for the revelations that those texts convey to us unwillingly on the mental attitude of monks of it, or of a duke and pair of France. And here, suddenly, Bloch compared the historian to a detective, quote, an insightful detective. If he questions himself upon the actors of a drama, does not look for an acceptable version of the facts. What he looks for is a series of elements that will allow him, by an effort of intelligence, to reconstruct the truth. Likewise, the best and most sincere statement is above all, in the historian's eyes, a clue. Many years ago, I wrote an essay on clues in which I compared the historian to a detective, Sherlock Holmes, to an art connoisseur, Giovanni Morelli, as well as to the founder of psychoanalysis, Sigmund Freud, who wrote to have been inspired by Morelli. In that essay, I mentioned Marc Bloch's Le Roi Thaumaturge, translated into English as The Royal Touch. I would not have been able to mention his reflections addressed to a reader curious about method, since at that time they were still unpublished. But my emphasis on clues was also indebted to Bloch, to his published work. Today, I would like to develop the remarks I made 35 years ago, looking more closely at Bloch's distinction between intentional and unintentional evidence and its implications. Bloch reworked and sometimes literally quoted his 1939 reflections in some notes prepared for the lectures he began in October 1940 in Clermont-Ferrand, where the University of Strasbourg had been moved. Etienne, his son, who attended the lectures, informs that those notes referred to the first two lectures. On October 18th, the Vichy government, issued a decree forbidding Jewish professors to teach. Those notes bear a title, Why and How a Historian Works, that Bloch wanted to use as a subtitle for his métier d'historien. The initial project to write a history of the French had been put aside. In a moment of danger for his country, for his family, and for himself, Bloch decided to focus on the historian's method. He was fully aware of the political implications of this topic, but a detached reflection must have been also an attempt to keep his anxiety under control. If we compare the different drafts of Métier d'Historien, some differences emerge. The argument became more and more elaborate, although it still followed the master lines drawn in 1939. In the last version, reworked in the first month of 1943, the importance of the distinction between intentional and unintentional evidence was emphasized with great energy. Quote, the great majority of the medieval lives of saints are unable to tell us anything specific about the pious individuals whose destiny they pretend to reconstruct. But if, on the contrary, we question them upon either the way of life or the thinking habits of the times in which they were written, issues that hagiography did not want to tell us, we will find them extremely valuable. We succeeded in disentangling ourselves from our inevitable dependence vis-à-vis the past, insofar as, although we are bound to know the past only from its traces, we succeed in knowing about the past much more than it wanted us to know. This is, after all, a great victory of intelligence over mere facts. Une grande revanche de l'intelligence sur les données. Some years ago, in the introduction to my book, Threads and Traces, True False Victim, I insisted on the importance of this passage. But there is much more to be said about it than I thought. First of all, who were the responsible for this turning point in historical history? In his 1939 Reflections, Bloch attributed the argumented critique of evidence, with a touch of ironical understatement, to, quote, some modest erudites named Papenbrock, Mabillon, Beaufort. They would have been astonished if somebody would have told them that by focusing on the lives of some obscure saints, Papenbrock, on the dull charters of Merovingian kings, Mabillon, or on the arrangements of Livy, Beaufort, stuff which used to be the exclusive domain of so many pedant professors, they were discovering, no more, no less, a new method of knowledge. Papenbrock, Mabillon, Beaufort, those names were mentioned at the very beginning of Reflections on War's False News, 1921, an essay in which Bloch started from his war experiences to explore the mechanisms of cultural transmission, both present and past. Many years ago, I pointed out the role played by those pages in Bloch's endless reflection on the historical method. Bloch had that essay well in mind, as well as on his desk, when another world war induced him to meditate once again on the historian's craft. In the last version of Métier, the name of Beaufort disappeared. Mabillon, on the contrary, came prominently to the forefront. The year in which Mabillon, the Benedictine monk, published his treatise De Re Diplomatica as a response to the skeptical attitude of Papenbrock, the Jesuit, vis-à-vis Merovingian charters, that year, 1681, is, Bloch wrote, undoubtedly a great date in the history of the human mind. What made the birth of modern historiography possible was, according to Bloch, the emergence of methods based on a close analysis of specific unintentional evidence, in a word, antiquarianism. Since many decades, the word antiquarianism is inextricably connected to Arnaldo Momigliano's famous essay, Ancient History and the Antiquarian, published in 1950 in the Journal of the Warburg and the Kutrov Institutes. In 1938, due to the racist laws issued by the fascist regime, Momigliano, then in his 30s, lost his academic position at the University of Turin, where I taught ancient history, and moved to England. In January 1949, he presented the first draft of his essay at the Warburg Institute, the institution born around the library of Abbey Warburg, that in May 1933, at the very beginning of the Nazi regime, had been transferred from Hamburg to London. Momigliano's great erudition, far from concealing the polemical edge of his essay, put an emphasis on it. Since more or less two centuries, antiquarians were considered innocent pedants, targets of a mild derision. Momigliano rediscovered the relevance of that research tradition, imposing it to the scholar's attention, an attention which, if I'm not mistaken, is today more alive than ever. Modern historiography, this was put in a nutshell, Momigliano's thesis, was born from the confluence between antiquarian methods and histoire philosophique à la Voltaire. Here is the essay's conclusion, quote, "The antiquary rescued history from the skeptics, even though he did not write it. His preference for original documents, his ingenuity in discovering forgeries, his skill in collecting and classifying the evidence, and above all, his unbounded love for learning are the antiquary's contribution to the ethics of the historian. We cherish the memory of Jean Mabillon not only for his De Re Diplomatica, but for the Traité des Études Monastiques, where he recommended, quote within quote, to have one's heart free from passions and above all that of criticizing. Avoir le cœur dégagé des passions et surtout de celles de critiquer." Here I will skip the section, it's maybe too long, I don't know, I would like to keep some space for discussion. Okay, let's read one page more. In Momigliano's essay, issued in 1950, there was no mention of Bloch's Métier d'Historien that had been posthumously published at the early summer of 1949. Between the dense reconstruction of the antiquarian tradition put forward by Momigliano and Bloch's insistence on the importance of antiquarians for historical studies, there was no direct connection. But a convergence between them exists, although, to the best of my knowledge, it has never been discussed. Both of them regarded antiquarianism as a powerful answer to historical skepticism, Pironisme historique, that rejected ancient historians as utterly unreliable. But since 1921, in his essay on War False News, Bloch had remarked that skepticism concerning evidence, quote, refers only to superficial issues. The history of law, of economy, of religion is not affected. What is deepest in history could also be what is most certain in it. And Bloch's later reflections on unintentional evidence were a development of this remark, which seems to anticipate the program put forward by the Annales d'Histoire Économique et Sociale, the journal founded by Marc Bloch and Lucien Febvre in 1929. Momigliano did not miss the connection between Bloch, as well as more generally social history and the antiquarian tradition. In his introduction to the Southern Lectures delivered at Berkeley in 1961-62, Momigliano noted that Thucydides, who had been regarded in the 19th century as the father of historiography, could no more be considered as such. Books like Huizinga's Waning of the Middle Ages, or Marc Bloch's Caractère Original de l'Histoire Rurale Française, or even Perry Miller's The New England Mind, cannot be presented as mere developments of the Thucydidian type of history. While these books also have their antecedents in antiquity, we must look for such in the field of antiquarian and erudite research rather than in the tradition of Thucydidian history. And here I will skip a section.
Please don't.
No? Well, okay. For decades, this passage remained unpublished. Momigliano's Southern Lectures came out posthumously under the title The Classical Foundations of Modern Historiography in 1990. In his own published writings, Momigliano always mentioned Bloch in praising contexts, sometimes marked by an ironical understatement. For instance, in the allusion to, quote, the historians we respect, from Herodotus and Thucydides to Edward Meyer and Marc Bloch, unquote. But Momigliano never commented upon the relationship between Bloch and the antiquarian tradition, even where such a comment would have been obvious. For instance, in the short, dense essay entitled The Rules of the Game in the Study of Ancient History, 1974. 10 rules are listed, a decalogue addressed not only to historians of antiquity, but to historians in general. In the conclusion, Momigliano's tone, often abruptly ironical, turns to solemnity. Quote, historians understand men and institutions, ideas, faiths, emotions, and needs of individuals who do not exist anymore. Historians understand all this because the evidence they are facing, duly interpreted, points to real situations. Historians understand the dead as they understand the living. To turn evidence into the life of the past, they learn from Herodotus, Guicciardini, Burckhardt, and Marco, more easily than from handbooks of historical method. As soon as we read the last sentence, we are inevitably reminded that Bloch did write not only about history, but about the historical method as well, although not in the form of a handbook, a literary genre he detested. But in the list that Momigliano attached as an appendix to his own essay, under the title Some Books on Historical Method, Arbitrarily Chosen, 26 titles as a whole, Bloch's posthumously published methodological reflections are not mentioned, but they seem implied in a passage which is more or less contiguous to the one I already mentioned. Quote, historians find in the letter the man who wrote it, in the degree the institution that issued it in specific circumstances. They find in the house those who inhabited it, in the grave the faith of the group to which the individual belonged. Historians interpret evidence as signs of disappeared people. They find the meaning of texts and objects they deal with because they understand them as if they would belong to the past situation to which they in fact belonged. Historians turn evidence into life of the past, Momigliano wrote. A commercial document, a fragment of pottery, the name of a person or the name of a place are traces. Quote, the point is to know how to extract life from them, Bloch wrote in his reflections addressed to a reader curious about method, a fragment that Momigliano was unable to read since it was still unpublished. He did read, however, Bloch's Métier d'Historien. The letter, the degree, the house, the grave listed by Momigliano are, Bloch would have said, unintentional evidence. Antiquarians taught to analyze them as evidence. Historians learned by antiquarians to turn evidence into traces, empreintes, traces of a life that vanished. The convergence between Momigliano and Bloch on this issue seems evident, but Momigliano's persistent silence upon Bloch's rediscovery of the antiquarian tradition cannot be easily explained. But a reflection on these topics must be pursued, starting from the distinction put forward by Bloch between intentional and unintentional evidence. More precisely, from his idea that unintentional evidence can be identified even within intentional documents. This idea and the practice which it implies, but they must be rigorously kept apart, have behind them a long historical trajectory, much longer, much more tortuous than Bloch had argued. I will focus on a few episodes only of this long trajectory. My research is still in its making. In one of his recorded private reflections, which were published only posthumously, the historian Francesco Guicciardini, friend and correspondent of Machiavelli, lamented that all historians refrained from, quote, writing many things that in their own times were well known, taking them for granted, unquote. For instance, he noted, histories of Rome, of Greece, and so forth do not say anything about political and military institutions, since everybody at that time was familiar with them. Antiquarians tried to supplement the historian's silence, assembling and analyzing a wide range of heterogeneous evidence, inscriptions, coins, literary texts. On this issue, the divergence between historians and antiquarians was as sharp as possible. But antiquarians tried to retrieve traces of phenomena regarded too obvious to be mentioned, not only in the historian's writings, aimed to search for truth, but in fictional writings as well. This somewhat paradoxical attempt brings us back to Bloch and his unintentional evidence, a topic which is at the very center of Jean Chapelain's De la lecture de vieux romans, on reading old romances, a dialogue that allegedly took place in Paris in 1647. It was published posthumously in 1728, more than 50 years after the author's death. Oh, sorry, no, this is not the right. Okay. Jean Chapelain, at that time a famous poet and critic, tells to have been surprised in the act of reading a medieval romance, Lancelot, by two friends. One of them, the erudite Gilles Ménage, asks, how can a man provided of good taste like Chapelain find something in a book that is despised even by the partisans of the moderns who reject the cult of antiquity? Is Lancelot, perhaps, Ménage asks in a sarcastic tone, a second Homer or a second Livy? At that very moment, the literary scene in Paris was dominated by the dispute between ancients and moderns, la querelle des anciens et des modernes. Ménage, a partisan of antiquity, is astonished in seeing that a partisan of the moderns could appreciate a miserable corpse, une miserable carcasse, like Lancelot. In his answer, Chapelain advances a paradoxical category. Lancelot had been composed, quote, in the darkness of our modern antiquity, composé dans les ténèbres de notre antiquité moderne. We have to recall that the Middle Ages had not been invented yet. It is a book written by a barbarian, Chapelain admits, by a man who had read only the Book of Nature. It is an invented narrative, a fable, as in the case of Homer's poems, although Homer is noble and sublime. Lancelot is rustic and servile. However, Lancelot gives us, quote, a faithful image, if not of that which really happened between the kings and the knights of that time, at least of that which was supposed could happen on the basis of relics of similar customs that had flourished in the past, unquote. Chapelain was deeply familiar with Aristotle's poetics, which he cites indirectly, pointing out that Lancelot tells, quote, of that which it was supposed would happen. But it tacitly turns Aristotle's plausibility into a historical plausibility related to a specific past. This shift paves the way to an appreciation of the medieval romance as, quote, a naive representation, as well as, in a certain sense, a sure and exact history of the customs that prevailed in the course of the day, unquote. Then, Ménage provocatively suggests, are we allowed to compare Lancelot with Livy, the great historian of ancient Rome? Yes, in a sense, Chapin answers, quote, it can be compared with Livy for the perfect images of manners and customs that they both convey, one of the times about which he wrote, the other of the times in which it had been written. Lancelot, we could say, is a Livy malgré lui, but also something different. Ménage draws the conclusions of Chapelain's argument. The author of Lancelot is, quote, the historians of his own times, especially because, sorry. It constitutes a supplement of existing chronicles. They tell us merely that a prince was born or that a prince died. They record the most important events of their reigns, and it all ends there. A book like Lancelot, instead, according to your description, makes us familiar with these people, even to the point of showing us the very essence of their soul. This polemical remark about the dryness of chronicles has a familiar ring, but the constructive side of Chapelain's remarks is more unexpected and more promising. Chapelain seems already committed to the attempt, described by Bloch nearly three centuries later, of constructing a kind of history that, within a medieval romance like Lancelot, an intentional piece of evidence, looks for traces of unintentional evidence. A naive representation, as well as in a certain sense a sure and exact history of the customs, mores, that prevailed in the course of the day. Retrospectively, we can say that the history of customs paved the way to social history, to the history of mentalities, or to both, but labels are ultimately irrelevant. More important is the idea of a history based mostly on evidence that, being unpolluted by the will of those who produced it, was therefore certain. As Bloch remarked, quote, what is deepest in history could be also what is most certain in it, unquote. As we have seen, in his dialogue, Chapelain articulated with remarkable lucidity the tacit assumptions of a practice widely shared by antiquarians. To pick up passages from ancient poems or from medieval romances as evidence of customs and juridical institutions of the past. In principle, Chapelain could have made the same point by referring, rather than to an obscure romance like Lancelot, to Homer's poems, which had been recently attacked by the partisan of modern taste. In this direction moved, in 1664, Claude Fleury, at that time lawyer at the Parliament of Paris. Later he became a priest and wrote a famous history of the church, warmly praised by Voltaire. Fleury was probably familiar with Chapelain's dialogue, at that time still unpublished. Fleury's youthful remarks on Homer remained also unpublished for more than 50 years. They came out after the death of their author, first as an anonymous text, then with a false attribution to Alexander Pope. Fleury begins by noting that Homer has now been discredited. Some critics dismiss his style as simple and coarse, simple and grossier. and the customs described in his poems as low and rustic, bas et rustic. In ancient Greece, on the contrary, Homer's poems were as respected as the Bible is among us. This seemingly neutral remark opens up a series of parallels between Homer and the Bible. Their style is similar. The Oriental comparisons of Homer's poems are similar to those that are scattered in the Song of Songs and in the Gospel's parables. It seems that Homer was born in Asia, we don't know exactly where, and that he was a Solomon's contemporary. The way in which the Greeks and the Trojans lived, as it is described in Homer's poems, is comparable to what we read in the Bible, shepherd kings and peasant kings, quote, although the Greeks seem to have been less civilized. Those who ridicule Homer's poems because their kings take care of cooking and are wealthy in livestock, Fleury went on, forget that Homer lived 3,000 years ago. At that time, man's life was simple and natural, and Homer, quote, could not guess how people born 30 centuries after him would have lived. And even if he would have guessed it, he should have accommodated to the customs of his own times. The key word in this passage is accommodate. Augustine had mentioned accommodatio, commenting upon the Bible, explaining that in the sacred books, God speaks a language which is accessible to human beings. The term accommodate referred to Homer, although in an hypothetical context, even if he would have guessed it, he should have accommodated, implicitly suggests an analogy. It would have been impossible to foresee how the Bible would have been read more than 30 centuries later. This implicit parallel opens up an unexpected argument, meaning that Homer's poems include allusions to customs and ways of living that readers of that time took for granted, but are invaluable now for the readers of the Bible. The same remark surfaces again more forcefully at the end of Fleury's text. Homer, quote, is one of the best interpreters of the Bible for those who seek only a literal meaning. Unquote. Fleury alluded to the unintentional informations which can be found in Homer's poems, insofar as they shared a context with the Bible. A development of Chaplin's remarks on Lancelot, but in which direction? Should we assume that Homer's poems were becoming once again a sacred book, as they had been to a certain extent in ancient Greece? Or was it the opposite? Reading the Bible as an Oriental text, comparable to Homer in style and comment, did not destroy the uniqueness of the Bible as a sacred text? Fleury worked on his remarks on Homer until 1665. 5 years later, an anonymous book was published in Amsterdam, entitled Tractatus Theologico Politicus. Its author, Baruch de Spinoza, rejected in the most radical way the sacred character of the Bible. Most probably Fleury read that scandalous book, but if he did it, we ignore his reactions. In any case, in a later book, Le Mœurs des Israélites, The Customs of the Israelites, published in 1681, Fleury, after a passing remark on the Bible as a text inspired by God, commented on the Bible not as a sacred book, but as a repertoire of antiquarian informations. Chapter after chapter, Fleury dealt with food, dresses, marriage, agriculture, warfare, commerce, and also, of course, religion. A contextual reading of the Bible as an Oriental book based on Homer, whose name is repeatedly mentioned. Fleury felt the need to declare his dependence from Homer in an explicit, nearly solemn tone, quote, now, I believe that Homer's authority, I must say this, about all this is indeed very great. He was a contemporary of Elijah, the prophet, and lived on the Near East Coast. Everything he says about the customs of the Greeks and the Trojans has a wonderful relationship with all the Bible says about the customs of the Hebrews and of other Oriental populations. But the Greeks, being less ancient, were less civilized. Fleury was quoting literally from his youthful notes on Homer. But to define the relationship, the concordance between Homer and the Bible, he added an ambiguous adjective, merveilleux. Wonderful, miraculous, it was up to the reader to decide. The same reader was invited at the beginning of Le Meurs des Israélites to quote specific ideas related to our country and our times, I'm quoting, in order to look at the Israelites within the circumstances of times and place in which they lived. By comparing them with the populations that have been close to them, we will be able to enter their mind and their principles, unquote. I came across these words for the first time many years ago in reading Amos Funkenstein's book, Theology and the Scientific Imagination from the Middle Ages and to the 17th century. The passage, Fleury's name shows up in the footnote, is quoted in a paragraph entitled Vico's Forerunners. The interest in Giambattista Vico's Forerunners is another side of the unpredictable posthumous impact of his work. Vico had been an isolated thinker, utterly remote, also for linguistic reasons. He was unable to read French, not to say English or German, from what was going on the European philosophical scene. His masterpiece, La Scienza Nuova, The New Science, first published in 1725, then republished in a deeply revised form in 1730, and with small variations in 1744, was rediscovered more than 50 years later, and then translated, commented, debated across the world until today. The crowd of Vico's readers and admirers includes individuals as different as possible, from Karl Marx to James Joyce. But La Scienza Nuova, a book that changed our way of looking at human history, is still, in many ways, an enigma. Here I have to skip a passage. there is a sort of quotation from Vico where he says, vulgar traditions must have had public grounds of truth. Actually, he was referring, I argue, to Fleury's Italian translation, since Vico was unable to read French. But anyway, and public grounds of truth, by virtue of which they came into being and were preserved by entire peoples over long periods of time. It would be a great labor of this science, here Vico is describing his own project, to recover these grounds of truth, truth which, with the passage of years and the change in languages and customs, has come down to us enveloped in falsehood. We are close to the topic of this conference. Enveloped in falsehood or in fiction, or in both. Early 19th century readers found in Vico's Scienza Nuova the favorite themes of the Romantic Age, the dawn of national histories, the truth beyond illusions. At the end of the 19th century, Marxist readers found in La Scienza Nuova the laws of historical development and an early example of a critique of ideology. Reading a text asking questions related to the present is a proof of the text's vitality. But in order to understand the intellectual context from which Vico emerged, one should look for a page written by Alessandro Manzoni in 1822. At that moment, Vico had been rediscovered in Italy, not yet in Europe, as it will happen a few years later through Jules Michelet's brilliantly condensed translation into French of La Scienza Nuova. Okay, skip again a passage, and Manzoni imagines that a genius, working on medieval evidence, a genius provided with insight and stubbornness would look for, quote, traces of the life of Italian population in the Middle Ages inside chronicles, letters, private charters. He will find out that The very small number of writers from that age did not want, or were not able, to select among the events they were witnessing the most important historical points, those which deserved to be transmitted to posterity. They noted some facts, but institutions and customs and the general condition of people, what would have been for us the most interesting novelty, was for them something natural and obvious, which did not deserve to be told. And we are already familiar with this feeling of disappointment. But Manzoni went on, nonetheless, there is an art that allows us to catch with certainty some very important revelations that escaped from the pen of the writer, therefore enlarging our knowledge through some solid inductions. So Manzoni explains that there are two Italian scholars or writers who been able to enrich our knowledge of those unintended revelations. One is Muratori, the great erudite, and then there is Vico. And Vico did not believe in most of the beliefs he recorded, rejected most of their ideas, but looked for a kernel of truth in those ideas that they seemed to record. He rejected their conclusions, but at the same time he established rules to advance some better ones based on those writers' unintentional revelations. Unintentional revelations. Rivelazioni involontarie. Vico, as interpreted by Manzoni, seems to anticipate Bloch's emphasis on the revelations that texts like medieval chronicles or Saint-Simon's memoir convey to us unwillingly. A passage Bloch himself reworked in the distinction between intentional and unintentional evidence. I point at the possible convergence, but maybe unintentional, between Vico and Bloch, and then I say that in the case of a Bloch who was writing in the 20th century, the idea of looking for an intentional truth in the antiquarian text inevitably implied a reference to Freud. But perhaps the convergence, which is also unintentional, between Vico and Bloch implied something else. Vico looked for truth in false and fictional evidence, but recognized with great energy the power of both, an element which is missing in Manzoni's extremely insightful reading. In his masterpiece, Le Roi Thaumaturge, Bloch did something similar. On the one hand, he demystified the legend, meaning the power attributed to French and English kings to heal people suffering from scrofula. On the other, he provided a deep analysis of the legend's impact. Following those two trajectories and their relationship amounts to read history against the grain. Many in this audience would have immediately recognized in this passage an allusion to Walter Benjamin's thesis on history. In one of the darkest moments of the 20th century, immediately after the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, on the eve of the Second World War, Walter Benjamin reflected on both history and historical knowledge, as Mark Bloch began to do at that very moment, in a very different spirit. Different, but perhaps not incompatible. What does reading history against the grain mean? If the production of historical evidence, and above all, of intentional historical evidence, is to a large extent rooted in the relations of production, and more generally, in the relations of power within a specific society, reading history against the grain amounts to identifying in that evidence the traces of oppression. In order to do this, one has to reconstruct, on the one hand, the perspective in which historical evidence has been produced, on the other, its impact, which may be the result of either implicit or explicit intentions, although, in the long run, unforeseen results usually prevail. But this is not enough. In a world like ours, impregnated with myths and lies, learning to read the evidence between the lines, looking for unintentional revelations, is more important than ever. It teaches us to recognize the force of myths and lies and to unmask both. Thank you.